hammered tonight.
Hey.
Let me, let's go ahead and call the work session to order for January 22nd, 2013. The next item will be citizen comments, and these will be comments on items that are not on the agenda. I would remind you that we have a practice we're trying to institute where if you do want to speak on a subject that is on the agenda or is not on the agenda, that you complete a speaker's card. This helps us with our record keeping because many of us would get up to talk and we don't really give our complete name or our address, and it's very important for the record. And Linda up there loves me because I do this, and I give these to Linda. So seeing no comments there, we'll move on to number three, presentation of Franklin Road sidewalks option, and we'll go ahead with this presentation, and I do have some people that want to address this.
I have Director of Engineering Paul Holzen with us tonight. One of the things we included in the current year budget was about $500,000 of funding that might help with a Franklin Road sidewalk. There had been dollars that have been contributed by development in the area, specifically what was called Jamison Station, but is really the Bella Franklin apartment complex that had contributed dollars towards sidewalk development. We looked at a potential of bridging those contributions with a cost for a sidewalk. Had heard some feedback both from the neighbors and some questions from board members. And Paul and engineering staff have developed some options for you to look at and consider as we talk about where we go with what's budgeted and how this may fit with discussion of capital priorities as well. So take it away, Paul.
Good evening. Thank you, Eric. We looked at mainly four options as we looked at this project and brought it forward. One was the sidewalk only, and we've already gone through all these slides, so I'll save us from going through each slide. And our main concern associated with the sidewalk only, which is the $552,000, was the impacts that sidewalk may have on the property owners that front Franklin Road, mainly because of the ditch, the utilities, some of the landscaping, the decorative fences that front Franklin Road. So as we looked at this, we thought, what else could we do? We looked at, well, what if we moved forward with just a half of the project? Essentially, we would enclose that ditch and do the curb gutter drainage system, which would allow the sidewalk to be built in its final location. Our estimated cost for that came out to be about $2.58 million. That would be the bare minimum to just construct to be able to make it permanent so that we do not have to go back and tear out an old sidewalk. It would not include things like street lights. We would, however, put in the infrastructure, such as the conduit, so that way we could come back with very little disturbance and add the entire project at a later date. Once again, that cost came out to be about $2.58 million and does not include the potential of utility relocations that may be necessary. We also looked at required.
Doesn't include it?
Does not include it. That is correct.
Thank you.
We also looked at, well, what if we did the full streetscape plan all the way from Harpeth River Bridge to Liberty Pike? The estimated cost for that project was about $6.95 million. Would allow the sidewalk to get constructed and the full streetscape implemented from the Harpeth River Bridge to Liberty Pike. And then the full project limit, which is what we've presented in numerous CIP meetings, is essentially from the Harpeth River Bridge to Harpeth Industrial Court, and that cost hasn't changed. It's around $9.72 million. So really just wanted to put these options out there. As far as moving forward with the sidewalk-only project, the engineering department's recommendation was to include it as part of your overall CIP plan and look at it holistically, mainly because moving forward with the sidewalk-only right now would have impact on those property owners, and we thought that the other projects were such a large scale should be considered as with all the CIP projects.
So that the two new options that you have not seen before are the east side only, which would be doing partial project of the streetscape elements, if you will, and that would involve not having to tear up the improvements down the line. So you would be able to have that sidewalk in place, and you would have taken care of that drainage and the associated sidewalk in that project. Item three is really just a shorter version of the full streetscape project, taking it only up to Liberty where you have connectivity to existing sidewalks, and so it's just not taking it as far. So those are two new options that engineering has developed. Part of what we heard is give us some other thoughts on how this might work. in the neighborhood with the costs associated with them, and this just gives you some more to consider and give us some feedback on.
Alderman Berger.
So let me go over this one more time. The east side streetscape only then would be the east side sidewalk only.
That is correct. We would have to put in the curb and gutter. Mm-hmm. We'd have to put in the storm drainage. One side only.
Okay. The full streetscape would have both sides with both sidewalks.
That is correct.
And lighting and all the whole.
Yes.
The whole, all the elements
all right,
you do.
The whole all the mm-hmm. elements. And the only other, the last one, of course, would then go up past the factory.
And that's been the project that's been in the CIP process the last couple go-rounds. That's been the described mm-hmm. streetscape project on Franklin Road. So
yeah,
we took an option of a shorter stretch of road.
Right.
And the sidewalk only would create a situation where we would have to go back and redo or tear up or...
That is correct. The sidewalk, if we went forward with the sidewalk only, it would not be built in its permanent location. Mm-hmm. There would be additional easement costs that we would have to incur. And it would one day be removed with the full project.
Paul, can you describe the proximity of that sidewalk and the sidewalk only versus this east side? Would the sidewalk be closer to the roadway because you're putting in the drainage and all that? Or
yeah.
That is correct.
Describe that a little bit.
Essentially, when you put in your curb and gutter, you're putting the storm drainage right there in that ditch, which allows the sidewalk to be much closer. Without putting in the underground storm drainage, you're forced to push that farther over towards the property owners, which starts to get really intrusive. And with the exhibits that are attached, we tried to really highlight some of the improvements that we would have to remove, such as fences, landscaping, and we would have to do this as an interim solution. And some of our concerns is that the property owners are not going to be very accepting of that fact of putting that sidewalk so close to their houses.
Alderman Barnhill, then Alderman McClendon.
I guess my question would be, full streetscape off of River Bridge to Ripley Pike at 7 million, full streetscape off of River Bridge to Harper Industrial 49.73. What, if for instance, we just took the full streetscape off of River Bridge to Liberty Pike, what else beyond Liberty Pike would be improved? I mean, that's not but a couple hundred yards. It can't be. No, not even more than that, is it?
You're correct.
So you're talking a couple hundred yards, $7 million.
That is correct, and I'd say the reason why it was extended is mainly because of the turn lanes into the park and to Harpeth Industrial, is to provide those intersection upgrades further down to help with traffic in the area.
Alderman McClendon.
Where did this project fall on our last CIP ranking?
I don't have the exact
number. It was
number
15.
Yeah, it was in 10 to 20, yeah, 15.
It was number 15 on the street part, and of course, we've already taken care of some of those, so it has lifted, but it ain't going away. I can tell you, it's
well,
not going away.
The reason I ask is because it just seems to me like we ought to be mindful when we do those rankings that they're supposed to mean something. And I mean, any one of us can put any project that we like on a committee meeting or on a work session meeting, and I dare say any one of us for the right project could get 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 people in here with signs for it, okay? But when we weren't sitting here with vested interests, when we were just exercising our thoughtful conscience, our collective importance for this project didn't make the top 10. And yet here we are isolating this project and going down a road towards discussing which of these options to pick as if it's a foregone conclusion. According to our last ranking done collectively, the option is E, none of the above. Now, I'm not against it, but we did the rankings. And if I wanted to put any of those other projects that haven't been funded that were ranked ahead of it by all of us on an agenda and get the people that liked that project to come in here and speak for it, then what would you tell them? I mean, again, I'm not against it. I just can't be as for it as some of the other projects that all of us voted were more important when we had the chance to do it without, you know, in a vacuum, which in some respects I would say to you is a little more honest measurement. Okay? When you're not sitting in front of the very constituents who would benefit from it. And look, don't get me wrong. Half of this project touches my ward. Okay? I'm not against it. But if we start, don't ask me to do another ranking if we're just going to come in here and pitch projects. Don't ask me to consider the top 40 that we might do. If we're just gonna rally our troops and wave flags until we get what we want. I'll do that, but don't ask me to do another ranking, because if this is how we're gonna go about it, then they don't matter.
Well, we'll be asking you to do another ranking, but with a different connotation. Alderman Martin?
Well, let me say, we all were not here, Dana. We all were not here when that list was made. We did talk about it, but we talked about the top 10, and that's what we've been addressing for the last 3 years. But as the time moves forward and we do more items on our priority list, this needs to be on it. And I'm sorry that the residents who are here, they do have a vested interest in it. They're sitting right there on the road. The sidewalk would go right in their yards, and people that are moving into the Bell, the Jameson Station, want connectivity, and we are trying to address that. And I'll look forward to hearing from whoever wants to talk.
Anybody else want to make a comment while I have go ahead, Alderman Berger, and we'll have Travis Hawkins and Mr. Klatt come on up.
I just want to make one more brief comment. I believe that we as a board need to really take a look at this because there is money there to put a sidewalk or sidewalks.
Sidewalk.
Mm-hmm. On one side?
Yes.
There is money there to put a sidewalk in on one side. Now, as much as most of us, or maybe all of us, would like to do the full streetscape project, we have major projects going on in the city, and we have major projects that have to be going on in the city because we have growth and we have businesses moving in, and especially I won't go into it, but we all know what those projects are. If we have the money, if this project, the full streetscape project, won't get done for 10 years or maybe 12, 15, who knows, then we better be talking about looking at putting and taking the money that we have been given for that sidewalk and put a sidewalk in, because we have a safety issue, which we're going to be talking about later tonight. We're looking at doing an ordinance because of a safety issue. Well, to me, this is a huge safety issue, because when I drive up and down Franklin Road, which is quite often, there are people walking on that street constantly, and not by themselves, but with strollers and children. And I don't like that. And I think that we need to take a good hard look at that, and we need a long, hard discussion on what's the best thing for all the citizens in this area, because we have a very active downtown.
See, Alderman Blanton, then Alderman Peterson.
Expanse of this project being $9 million, we fought tooth and nail to get South Carruthers passed last time we met, and that was to try to get ahead of development. I agree this needs to be done. I think it is a safety issue. I mean, every festival we have, we offer parking at other places that are blocks off of Main Street so people can, you know, walk down there. But we don't have the funding piece here, which is what we tend to always get to eventually. And I think we also know there's some projects coming up in Cool Springs. We went to the chamber meeting last week. I mean, they're planning on building this massive building. We know that's coming. I think we need to look at the list if we're going to go by the list, like Dana says. I do somewhat understand what Bev is saying. We've got this money in there, and I hate to put something down that's going to be torn up, but realistically, let's look and see what can be done, how much time it's going to take to get it built, are we looking at, it's been joked about in the beginning when this came up, are we talking it's going to be 10 years later that we finish streetscape? I mean, realistically, let's look at the timeframe and the budget, and I think we can make a better decision then, instead of just not knowing what the checkbook is and sitting here and writing a blank check for something we all want and need. So I don't know when that funding piece comes in, and I think that's the big chunk that's missing, because we all have people that want it. I think connectivity is important, especially downtown. I know that's the one missing link to connect a lot of the Franklin. Mindy, you know more of those regions and things, but it's the one missing piece that we don't have to make a tremendous amount of paths for different reasons. So I'm asking for the financial piece and the time piece.
Alderman Peterson.
Yay!
Ditto.
And I think that's the basis of our recommendation on this, is that, you know, we tried to look at an option that used the existing funds and what could be done within that framework. There were questions about that, so we wanted to show you in a context of something that didn't tear it up that might be less intrusive into people's yards. What does that look like? It's not inexpensive, obviously. So when we start getting into these kind of dollar ranges, it does make sense to start to fit that into the update of the capital plan, which we're looking to do here in the next couple months, to give you updated information on those projects and share that with you. I'd expect by the end of this quarter we share that information with you, and that process begins. Now, our funding capacity, there's not a lot of capacity there. That's going to be part of the discussion as well. So this started with the discussion of how do we use the money we have to make something work, and then there's questions about how workable that solution was, and so we came back to show you what the other options at least look like. We weren't attempting to try to totally solve that for you, but wanted to give you at least a little more of a complete answer of what those options look like, and obviously they're expensive.
Have you spoken to the property owners along that side of the go sidewalk option only? Because I've talked to a couple, how about that for grammar? I've spoken to a couple, and some of those would have to have some rock walls removed, and they were all about it just for the connectivity.
Yeah.
So I don't know if we've kind of built a consensus of property owners.
They're here.
Yeah, I would say I specifically have not spoken to them, but I do know that our staff has been meeting.
I think we've had other staff, and I know the mayor had a meeting with some folks too along the way, was requested, and so there has been some communication. I don't know if there's been a lot of formal effort to get every single property owner, but there have been a number of concerns expressed. That's in part why we developed these options.
Mr. McCoy, I have one comment before.
Sure.
As we talk about our older neighborhoods and sidewalks, I think we don't necessarily need to cherry pick. I think we need to look at downtown. We need to look at some of our older neighborhoods and see what their sidewalk concerns are, because those are the things that a lot of us also hear about. So I think before we just gung-ho, go in one direction, I agree. I think there's a great need for sidewalk along the Franklin Road, but I also realize that there's other neighborhoods and streets in the downtown area, older in the the downtown area, that also need to be considered and looked at.
Alderman McClendon.
Well, the comments.
Nobody suggests that this isn't an important project. My comments, and again, I'm not against it, but I tend to be a process kind of guy. And if we want to, I mean, basically what's being suggested is that we bump this ahead of other projects that were ranked. And I realize that not everybody was here, but if every 2 years we have an election, we reshuffle the deck, we'll never get anything done. or we will devolve into a scenario where it's you and three, and if you come in and get three people with you, you can get whatever project you want. And it used to be like that. And that was a lousy way to do things. Okay, so I'm not against this project. I might even be happy to push it higher on the list. But I think the appropriate process is not to start looking at again, we could bring any one of these projects in and sell it on safety. We could bring any one of these projects in and sell it on the neighborhood. You know, they want it. We could bring any of these projects in and make the case for them. if we're going to consider this project, we should know what it will bump, what it will mean we cannot do, what the likely timeframe for doing it is, okay? And maybe we should consider reopening the you know, looking at the CIP ranking that we did, crossing off what we've managed to get done, and evaluating whether or not we, you know, 3 years later, we feel the same about the rankings. But this project or any other, I would say this about, we cannot have our favored pet projects that we get people riled up for and have people start email campaigns for without looking at the whole process that we go through to allocate scarce resources. A $2.6 million sidewalk that is a few hundred yards long is a special project, okay? I'm not being derogatory about it, but that, I railed about Columbia Avenue and it cost less. It cost less, and we did a whole road, okay? I think this is an important project, but reasonable people must agree that if we do this, we won't be able to do something else, and we need to lay this project next to those others that will get kicked down the road, and be prepared to tell those other projects and the people that want them, you can't have yours because we're doing this. And until we can have that conversation, I can't support this or any other of these worthy projects in a vacuum.
I have a note here from Ray Folia, who would like to ask members around the table to turn your cell phones off. It's playing havoc with the wireless mics. So thank you for consideration. Let's go ahead and have some residents come up and speak. I've got Travis Hawkins, Dan Clatt, Mindy Tate, and Ernie Bacon. So, and I'll limit you to a couple of minutes. There's some latitude there on my part.
Thank you for having me. I'm Travis Hawkins. I've got a vested interest. I live on Old Liberty Pike, and I've been walking that space of road there for about 15 years now, walking through my very patient neighbor's yards. I do understand what the difficulty that this board faces with money decisions, and this is my little girl. This is Willa. She's 5, and she wants everybody to know that. So I do understand the money decisions that you guys have got to go through. The first reason I'm here is to speak on behalf of numerous citizens who filed a petition. You guys should have it. It's in excess of 100 names, a lot of the people that are on that road have basically opposed the idea of putting in a sidewalk that's temporary. I think it sounds like that's what your engineering department is recommending also, to not do that. And that's the first thing we wanted to say, was that we'd rather be patient and wait for the full project or whatever part of the project we can accomplish without essentially spending $500,000 on a sidewalk that could get torn up. I think that's the consensus among everyone I've talked to. You may hear from someone else tonight, but I think that's the general consensus among people that are interested and who signed that petition. I saw some people shaking their heads, so some of those folks don't have a petition, and we will get a copy to everybody.
I didn't get it. Got it to you on. I don't know whether you got it out to everybody or not.
Yeah, internal staff, yes, but it did not get you out in time for the board members, okay. So that is correct.
As for the project itself, I understand that this board has to consider a lot of other projects and weigh a lot of other projects. I will ask the board to keep an open mind, because things change. Businesses come in. In this case, you have $500,000 that was funded by a private party for this sidewalk that you've got in the kitty already. And then now you've got 300 new units that are coming online up there in those apartment complexes, and a terrific amount of foot traffic coming down that street. Jamison Station, which has sat empty kind of like a ghost town for since the market crashed in 07. We hope that that place will start generating a lot of new revenue for the city. So I ask you not to be short-sighted about what this project will do for the city as an investment. It's a connector to a lot of money that this city has already invested in, that private parties have invested in. You know, I've invested in. I've invested in that street because we love that street. We love Franklin. But, you know, you've got Harlansdale Park. You've got Mr. Lehue's factory that just sold for $24 million. You've got Jameson Station. You've got those apartment complex. And you got a whole mess of people running up and down those streets. So if you would just reconsider this as you get into your capital improvements and you think about this as one that could come up, move up the list. And I understand you've got to debate that, but we'd ask that you consider putting this high on the list because I'm a native of Chattanooga, and I think that Franklin should look to cities like Chattanooga as a great model for development of a city and really stress the walkability of this town, and it would connect up so much that this city is lacking. So thank you for your time, and good luck in the debate.
Good evening. My name is Dan Clatt. I'm here tonight as a board member of the Downtown Neighborhood Association. Let me just point out a couple of things. As a former alderman, 9 years ago, considering when Jameson Station was a twinkle in a developer's eye, is when I made the recommendation and the motion to make this development pay toward the streetscape project, which at that time was a top priority. So priorities do change. I understand that. But the reason for the $1,800 per unit was to get ahead of the development. We are now behind the development in this corridor. It's as simple as that. You all talk the same thing that we talked about 10, 8, 6 years ago. Let's get ahead of the development curve. Well, here you're behind it. This money should be spent for the full streetscape project. Priorities do change. You will look at the CIP priorities again. I suggest that you look at this one as one of the crumbling infrastructure projects that needs immediate attention. It needed immediate attention 10 years ago. It has drainage issues, it has safety issues, it has sewer issues, it has water issues, and the reason it was a priority at that time was because of the utility infrastructure to connect from behind the factory to the Hillsborough Road project, which was also a priority 10 years ago and is now getting ready to be under construction. The point is, it takes longer than any of us think or would like for some of these things to happen. But it is a priority to downtown, and if you're talking economic development, there is no better economic development generator than our downtown. And we have proved that over and over and over again. And I think it's important that you as aldermen and elected officials represent the entire community by understanding the importance of our historic downtown. And when people visit from out of town, that's where they go. And that's where they need to be safe, and that's where they need to be able to walk and shop and spend their money, and tax dollars will stay here. The money is not intended to be spent on a temporary sidewalk or a partial project. The money was extracted and intended to be part of the streetscape development project in that corridor. You need a good intersection at Harlansdale Park, which this board has purchased and is improving. You need a good intersection at Liberty Pike. You need safety along that corridor, but it needs to be done right, and it needs to be done once. Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Mindy Tate, Executive Director for Franklin Tomorrow, and we have reviewed with you in the past the outcomes of the 2011 Vision Fair process, which we conducted with the citizens. Number one strategy that the citizens said was important to them was to see implementation of the city's open space, adopted open space and greenways master plan and streetscape. That is what the citizen said was the number one, of number one importance to them. As Alderman Blanton mentioned, the connectivity that is involved in this section of Franklin Road is significant as it relates to the entire city. If this sidewalk portion were completed, whether as full streetscape or sidewalk only, it provides connectivity from the city's northern boundary on Carruthers Parkway with the city of Brentwood, south along Carruthers to Liberty Pike, west to Liberty Pike. The only sidewalk interruption there is where the intersection with Mac Hatcher Parkway to Franklin Road. Franklin Road is interrupted, but with the city's completion of the 3rd Avenue North connection to Hillsborough Road, it would then connect the city's northern side through the private trail at Chestnut Bend, which is a quasi-public trail, or the use of the Hillsborough Road streetscape project all the way to Fieldstone Farms, where there are sidewalks along Hillsborough Road that take you to Fieldstone Farms. The impact of this portion of roadway to connectivity is huge. I'm not Solomon, and I'm glad I don't have to make the decision as to full streetscape or one side or the other, but we want to point out that this is extremely important to connectivity in our city. Third, I would implore you to realize the money you've spent on so far on the park at Harlansdale Farm, not just the purchase of it, but within the last year, you've spent close to $1.5 million for the stabilization of that park and hopefully for it to begin to pay for itself as a tourism capital. If you don't connect it to the city's downtown, it will never realize its full potential. It must be connected. And I would have to counter all those statements or just point out that in our survey that we did with the Williams County Association of Realtors, through a grant from the National Association of Realtors, residents want you to figure out how to pay for it. And I applaud Alderman Peterson and Alderman Blanton for asking for that financial question. And that is there. Most citizens say they feel the taxes they pay currently are about right for the services they receive. But this is an important project, and we would just stress that the citizens' number one strategy for the future of Franklin was to see implementation of the city's adopted open space greenways master plan and streetscape. And we encourage you to fully consider this project as you reevaluate the capital improvements plan. Thank you.
I'm Ernie Bacon. I live at 224 4th Avenue South. I'm speaking tonight in favor of the full streetscape to Liberty Pike. I do that in realization that this project is part of the whole of our community, as we have obtained Harlansdale Park and we're in the process of improving that. We have additional residents and housing units in that area that are literally moving in as we speak. So the prior points are well made. I simply would add to that this is a part of the whole of developing our town and continuing to enhance our town. And one short reference I would make too, that it is not appropriate, in my opinion, to view this as benefiting the property owners. True, they are impacted more than anybody, but this benefits the entire community, and I think we need to keep that in mind. So I join the others in saying I wish you well in your endeavors. This project, I would hope, would be part of the discussions going forward in the next few months as you look at prioritizing. And we recognize that those priorities are not necessarily static. They do move. Things are achieved. So that's why, in my opinion, you folks go through that annual exercise to prioritize these projects. Thank you.
Number four, overview of TML, Tennessee Municipal League Prescription Drug Card Program.
You are representing the residents there. They do not want the sidewalk only.
That's right.
on the east side sidewalk on the Harperville Bridge Liberty Pike. Is that an option? You see, when we break this down to CIP, we can split, we can break, it's in CIP now, it's in our funding. You can break this down project step by step by step by step, and you might get a different funding, you might get a different priority on the east side only, Harperville Bridge to Liberty Pike, than you would full streetscape at almost $10 million. So I guess sidewalk only is not an option. Any of the other three would be considered acceptable options?
Obviously, that I think that they're acceptable, and I hate to give short shrift to the folks on the other side of the road, because I know they'd like to be able to get down there also. And so I think the preference is for us to do the full project, and I realize the pocketbook may not allow for that. But most definitely the temporary sidewalk is collectively a no.
Okay.
Because we all feel like that would be a waste of money. And the preference among all of us would be to have the full project done. But obviously to get some connectivity is better than none at all. So that's something the board will have to grapple with when it considers the projects. But I think speaking collectively for the group, I don't want to sell the guys across the street down the river. So I would say, no, we prefer the whole thing, but obviously we'd like to be able to walk. We'd like as much connectivity as you guys can get.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, do we have a date on the CIP review?
We had looked at doing that by the end of the first quarter, to at least get you the updated project listing,
March.
And then work with you in that process going forward. So that's what we looked at providing that, so that we could see where we were with the projects, update priorities, see how those fit, and that would be something we do the first part of this year.
I think the sooner we can do that, the better, because mm-hmm. I think there's other opportunities as well that people will be interested in.
Okay.
So we need to go ahead, and my vote would be that let's do that sooner rather than
what
later.
What do you mean the first part of this year?
First half of the year. I mean, you know how the priority process,
yeah.
We don't put a timeline on that, because that's your discussion,
but
and your back and forth.
Started.
But we've collected, and David Parker's worked on the update of the project descriptions and the projects that staff is submitting for consideration in that process. So that is already underway, and we were going to hopefully get that to you. My goal was around the end of this first quarter of this calendar year, and then have that process move forward with you all starting to do the prioritization and how we want to work with that.
Could I just ask, will the Bell property, that those apartments behind
mm-hmm.
the factory, will they will be contributing to?
They're the ones that have contributed this money.
Yep.
That has come from that development.
What about Jameson Station?
They contributed.
That is the development that has contributed the $460,000 to this date.
As they move in, or as they have occupancy, they will be contributing also. So there will be more money coming in.
Not a whole lot more. You've gotten most of that money. Most of the money is reflected.
Okay.
Now, you've received the bulk of that money.
Okay.
Let's put it that way.
But I also want to point out that it's not just the sidewalk. I have been told by the residents that the drainage, the water and sewer, all of those things out there need to be redone, that they are crumbling. And so that always enters into it. It's not just a sidewalk.
That is for the full streetscape project.
Right.
That is correct.
And that's basically our recommendation was to look at a more permanent solution,
yes,
through some variation of the streetscape project, whether that's all the way to Industrial Court or Liberty, but some variation of that through your CIP process, so that you work that through with the rest of your priorities.
What part of the sewer is crumbling?
It's really storm drainage, I think, is what you're talking about. That's more what I've heard than
it's not crumbling.
Actual
There are locations that need replaced, but it is fine at this point, and we would delay that until the project. And if there is a major problem, we would bring it back.
If there's a problem, we've got a water and sewer department, and we need to address it from the water and sewer department. If we've got a major problem of crumbling infrastructure currently there and there's a problem or whatever, that's not something that you wait on 10 years for a streetscape project to be done on this right here. That's something that needs to be addressed. So make sure when we're referring to something that's crumbling, that it is, I guess, truly crumbling.
Alderman Beers, can you have a comment?
Yes, I did. Just to echo the comment that since we have approved projects recently, there's not a lot of capacity at this point, and I think that must be a part of this proposal to look at additional projects.
Okay, now, overview of TML prescription drug card program.
I want to ask our administration interns to come up and present this. This is one of the research projects they've worked on this week to look at a prescription drug program that's out there. There's some different variations of this kind of program across the country, and there's a specific one targeted for the state of Tennessee that I'd like to let them describe to you tonight.
Hi, I'm Brooke Young, and this is Rachel Massoud, and we've been the interns here with the city for the month of January. And
we like it.
And we'd like to thank you for this opportunity to present our research to you all. In the agenda is the flyer for the Tennessee Municipal League Prescription Drug Card Program, and this program is free to the city as well as free to the citizens. For this card to work, the citizen will present the card at any of the 56,000 pharmacies in Tennessee that will accept it, and then they will receive their discount on their prescription drugs. This card is also valid for the generic brand of their drugs. And on the flyer and as well on the screen, you'll see some of your top pharmacies, such as Target, CVS, Rite Aid, Walgreens, out of those 56,000. And last year, the average discount was 35%, which benefits the insured, uninsured, and underinsured as well. So this program is definitely something that everyone can benefit from, and being free makes it even better. And now Rachel is going to talk to you a little bit about the city's steps.
So we have been in contact with Harry Sale. He's the program director for the TML prescription drug cards. And basically, there's no sign-up procedure. What we would have to do is the city would have to send Franklin's high-resolution logo to Mr. Sale, and then he would print us customized
cards,
and we could distribute them at various points throughout the city and City Hall. We could do it at different pharmacies. There are many options. And Harry and his team would be happy to provide us help with the PR and marketing free of charge. The benefits manager for the program is Restat, and we were thinking it might be a good idea to distribute the cards to city employees. This would by no means replace their insurance or anything of that nature. It would just be another benefit option for them. And the city employees aren't our main target. Our main target are the uninsured and underinsured citizens of Franklin, but it could also benefit them as well. So we're happy to answer any questions, if we can, that you all would have.
Really, what the board would provide is an endorsement of the program. It's not our program. It's a program that's available and marketed through Tennessee Municipal League and gives people the access to various discounts. Depends on the drug, depends on the service, but there's a whole variety of those. It's sort of like a ongoing coupon that people could access through just having that card that has the city logo and the Tennessee drug card. It's pretty straightforward in that regard. So,
Alderman Peterson, then on.
I was so pleased whenever I heard about this, because I had said to some of you before that I had seen the little card from the National League of Cities telling about this, and I thought it just seemed to be such a thing that could be helpful to so many people, and it didn't cost anything to us or to them. And so I was really pleased whenever I found out that you had done the work on this.
Is it correct that I see a subscription glasses and hearing aids as well?
Yes.
Potential for discounts on those?
Yes. Our understanding is that you would have to use specific companies for LASIK surgery, teeth whitening. Those are all options, but I think it's one specific company that you would have to use.
Great.
Alderman Martin and Alderman.
I just wonder where in the world they're getting the money for all this. I've never heard of anything just falling out of the sky like this. Hard for anybody, anytime, anywhere, for anything.
It's much more.
Nothing is free.
It's like streetscape.
Actually, I can take turns a little bit because there's a similar program the National Association of Counties offers, and we did it where I came from in Hamilton County, Ohio. It's really essentially a discount program off of the full cost, and essentially there's a little bit of margin that that company makes for connecting that customer to that specific pharmacy. But you're not in that deal. You're not, it offers that discount. Typically, most insurance discounts are better than this, but in some cases, this might be beneficial. And those who have different insurance programs, this might be more beneficial to some than others. But it's a very simple program. I kind of kicked myself that we didn't enter the program a couple years earlier because we just sort of knew it was around and then finally got to it a couple years later, and it was very successful and people, very easy to use. Very easy to use.
Get your teeth whitened, get your hearing fixed, get your eyes fixed, everything.
Mark, tax dollars, yours and mine.
No tax dollars, no cost.
Well, I'm with you, Margaret.
It's a marketing outreach.
Nothing is ever free. But so someone's paying for it somewhere. So I don't understand that either.
Well, there's a process going on between that company who markets the service and drives that customer to that specific outlet.
You just said we're not doing that.
We don't pay any money for it, but there is some transaction that's going on between that marketing company and those specific pharmacies.
Yeah,
but that's not a process we're involved in. That's part of how they market and gain access to folks that are needing the services or purchasing the drugs. No.
No, absolutely not. And I've talked to Mr. Sale multiple times, and I've said, you know, this seems too good to be true. And when they talked about the marketing, I was like, well, would we pay you for that? No. Like, they're...
Because you can get somebody into the pharmacy, they not only buy their
other stuff
thing, but they're going to make other purchases. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're right. Very marketing-oriented.
I'm going to say, this says Walmart on here. I think that's not one you mentioned, but you did mention Walgreens, CVS, mm-hmm. Rite Aid, a lot of
pretty
things that people use here a lot, but also Walmart, you know.
Okay. Good job.
If you're interested, we'll pull some together
yes.
with an endorsement.
Gave the interns a real softball there.
Yeah.
Right? We only had 3 weeks, you know.
They're not indentured.
Okay, number five, consideration of event permit application for Metal Mushroom Concert Series, second Saturday of the month from March to October. Any questions about that one?
No.
Number six, concert.
It's always me that asks.
You don't like a party.
Mm-hmm. Yes. No, I don't want a party. I don't know that. They want to close down the parking, but then... If you close down the parking, the only thing you've got then is the street for the buffer. So now, what are they going to do with those 8 or 9 parking spaces?
It gives them more area for patrons to be in that
exactly.
that area. So they've sort of barricade that off, and that it's a concert they've been doing the last, at least this last summer, maybe the summer before as well. And so as they have, people are drawn to it and they hang out and there's just not as much room to do that, they end up sort of clogging the sidewalk. So this gives a little more area, and to use just the parking in that quarter of the square is the option that's being discussed.
But by the description you just given, what happens is whenever we block off the parking space, then it becomes the norm then to get on the other side of the parking space, which means that you're out in the street. You know, at some point in time, somewhere it has to stop, somewhere it has to end, and I don't see how. It would appear to me that you control it now by having the 8 cars parked there, and there's a buffer between the traffic that's going around. You've got 8 cars parked, and the patrons on the street. Now you're saying, now I'm hearing, that we're putting a car within a few feet of a patron there with relatively little of anything in between the traffic that's going around, because they're not going to stop the traffic.
Right.
We're just blocking off 8 parking spaces.
Is there a physical barricade?
Yeah, the barricades will be there. They're the water-filled barricades that can't just be easily knocked down.
They're not sawhorses. They're the...
Jersey barriers. In addition, we'll also have 2 off-duty, extra-duty officers to assist with the Jersey barriers.
So who moves the barriers? Who puts those down?
Our streets department does.
Are they hired to do that?
Yes.
They're hired to do that. Okay.
No. They're paid by Mellow Mushroom over and above what they normally make to do that, right? Is that what you're saying?
They pay the city, is that what you mean?
That's what, okay,
yes.
Same difference.
Yes, they pay for that service. And they pay for the officers that are special detail officers.
And how many Saturdays did they have it last year?
They had it once a month. This year is March to October. I think it was every month during the summer. Last year?
There's 8 dates this year that they've been.
It was probably not that much last year.
It wasn't that much last year. Maybe 5.
Yeah. Did any of them conflict with Main Street Festival or anything that's already going on?
No.
It's always Saturday night, too.
Well, it may be only Saturday night, but he's asking that the street be closed, the parking places be set up.
We've got to do it in the morning.
We do that. We do that just because people will park there and we'll have a hard time getting the cars out, so we usually block it off that morning.
That makes sense.
So you lose a parking for the entire day. Okay, well, I've made my little point, and whatever appears to be wherever it is, you know, that's 8 Saturdays that we don't have 8 parking spaces on Main Street. So, okay. All right.
Consideration of event permit application for Tour de Cure bike ride sponsored by the American Diabetes Association in Cool Springs area, May 18th, 2013. Consideration Main Street Brew Festival in downtown Franklin on March the 16th. Item 8, the applicant has asked to have this withdrawn, and they plan to take it back to the Planning Commission. So we'll need a motion to withdraw it later tonight. Number 9, consideration resolution 2012-72, a resolution to remove all traffic calming devices on Fair Street between 7th Avenue and 11th Avenue.
This had been discussed at our last meeting based on a specific petition from residents. Had a request that this be on for further discussion tonight, so we're bringing that back for you. And I guess I would throw one other option out from a just having thought about this a little over the weekend. The thing that's missing is there's been one question asked. There's do you want them or do you not want them completely? We could do a survey that is a little more inclusive of the 2 or 3 options, which are remove one pair of them, remove all of them, explore a different traffic calming method, which could be the speed humps, et cetera, which I understand had been rejected originally, which is why these ended up in place. So we could do it. We could work with the neighborhood to do a more complete survey of that group. That's another option just to think about if you think that would help get more of a conclusive feedback from the neighborhood as opposed to just one question when there's really a couple different questions that were circulating in the discussion 2 weeks ago. So I just throw that out as another element to consider. If we're looking to try to get a sense of what the neighborhood is asking.
Alderman Skinner.
If we want the neighborhood to vote on which one of the traffic calming devices are left, which one are taken out, basically that's...
Well, yes, yeah.
I think I had Alderman Skinner after.
Let's go what was just said. There's options within the petition that say specifically which traffic calming device or what traffic calming devices or options besides all or nothing. So that means that you're going back around with another petition then and call, and I'm assuming Carl will do that. Is that
we would work with the neighborhood to do that.
Work with the neighborhood to do that. Because Carl didn't do this petition.
Right.
That's correct. We would put the exhibits together.
We assist, but the neighborhood is usually the one, it's usually neighbor generated. It's not, we don't just go out and survey randomly. We let them tell us what they want and assist them in that. But what we heard back from some of the residents last meeting was an option that wasn't even on here.
Yes.
And so I don't know if you want us to help facilitate that or facilitate a more complete survey that includes more than one option.
Alderman Skinner, then I've got Berger, and then Alderman Peterson.
I think this is a good idea to go back and get more feedback from the, because the complaint is cars drive too fast through here. Well, some people complain, well, they hit the speed bump, the bumper sometimes. But if we take all of them out, we still haven't dealt with the problem. But I don't want to go out and start delegating what we think everybody needs. But I think if we go back and work with the neighborhood to have these other options, so that if it is speed humps and things like that, we don't turn around and argue about this a year from now. Because we've got a policy that says, you know, once we take things like this out, it's supposed to be a number of years. Well, and then we say, well, but, you know, we can change that. But then everybody else we tell, this is what our policy is. So once you start making exceptions to the policy, that's a standing policy, it's hard to enforce it when you go to other locations. So we've learned in the past, the more feedback we can get from the neighborhood, the better off we are, and for them to have more choices on what they want on their street.
Alderman Berger.
I agree, we need more feedback. Margaret, you're the ward alderman. Actually, when these things come up, I would like to hear from the ward alderman first, because you're the one that's supposed to be connected to your ward. You're talking to these people, and I would appreciate, basically, when we get into these sessions, to hear first from the person who represents that area, and then have us have our opinions after that, because you're talking to these people. And Margaret, what do you think? Because I'm actually confused about what they want and they don't want, and I'm confused about what really needs to take place here, if anything. So my recommendation would be for you to work with staff and administration and then bring something back to us. What do you say, may I ask?
Well, I'd be happy to do that. We know how some of them feel because they've had a petition signed. We also know that some people signed the petition who didn't really understand it.
Right.
And who really didn't know exactly what it meant. We also have a group that is happy with the traffic calmness in their section, on their section of Fair Street. So I would be happy to do that if that's what you want to do. I personally think that the people who want the traffic commas in front of their house ought to be able to have it. Now, I know that engineering does not agree with that because you say all or none. But if the cars are extending into the street more than the traffic commas, then the traffic commas aren't going to be hit like they are up at the other end of the street. Now, I would like to hear from some of the residents. I know how Ann feels, and I know how Sam feels. Do you have anything else you want to say?
I've got Alderman Peterson on hold, and I do have one card from Ann Little that wants to speak. I don't have one from anybody else, but if anybody else wants to address
it. Fill out a card.
It's not for me. Okay. It's for Linda. Okay. Go ahead, Alderman Peterson.
My concern is that if there are more options, there may not be a consensus on any of them.
Good point.
That's the real difficulty that I have.
You can have any color you like as long as it's black.
Well, apparently a petition was turned in that satisfied the conditions that were in our policy. And it did have, I believe our policy said 51%. If 51% agreed, then something would occur. But as I say, my real concern is that there would not be a consensus on anything.
And that maybe I'm just, you know, not being optimistic enough, but I think that is entirely possible. I will have to say, whenever I drove down there a couple of days ago, there's really not enough room for parking on the street and two lanes of traffic. You know, whenever you see that yellow line down the middle of the street, that there is no way, not just for these, the bump outs here, if there are cars parked on the street, you cannot pass them without going on the yellow, over the yellow line. And I don't have a big car. So, really, there are a lot of difficulties there.
Okay, we've got Ann Little, Brian Bethard, and Sam Whitson.
Oh.
Let's move on. Come on, we've got a long agenda yet to go.
Can we ask Brad to check the air conditioning? I'm like freezing.
It's working perfectly.
Yes, it's working perfectly. I feel like an old maid, but that's all I got. I'm freezing.
Well, I'm glad you brought a blanket.
Thank you.
I'm Sam Whitson, live at 803 Fair Street. Again, thanks for this opportunity to fight City Hall. Just real quick, the current 800 block residents with bump outs in front of their property want to retain them and maintain them. Fair Street is wider in the 800 block with the bump outs in the busy 11th Avenue. 24 feet 4 inches versus 21 feet 7 inches. The bump outs do not cause people to go past the yellow line. Parked vehicles extend 2 to 4 feet into the street, more than the bump outs. Bump outs in the 800 block solved a congested parking problem that we had in the past. Without the bump outs, there will be more street parking in the 800 block and more cars having to pass on the yellow line. The city engineer's recommendation stating that bump out removal will have no financial impact or cost is not correct. New curbing with bump outs have been installed after the sewer project. Bump out removal in the 800 block will require new street design work, demo of the newly installed bump outs, and new concrete curb work and construction. Bump outs in the 1000 block that are causing the problem are not part of the spring repaving project as stated in the staff recommendation. That part was not given a new sewer line. The bump outs in the 1000 block of Fair Street are the problem. They extend 6 feet into the roadway on each side and reduces the width of the street to 19 feet 11 inches. They are the source of all traffic accidents and are approximately 0.2 miles from the 800 block bump outs. The city engineer staff recommended another petition to remove only the 1000 block bump outs, after previously stating that all bump outs must be removed if some are removed. That's confusing to the neighborhood. I'm recommending a compromise. Remove the ones that are causing the problem in the 1000 block. Keep the ones that we want in the 800 block that do not impede traffic and add to the aesthetics and the parking problem, solves parking problems we've had in the past. You're right, ma'am. The cars stick out much further in the street down there. You can make 80% of the estimate 80% of the Fair Street residents happy by removing just the 1000 block bump house. Thank you.
You want to make that a motion?
Yeah.
No, that's an estimate.
That sounds fair.
Brian Bethard, 704 Fair Street. I actually didn't come planning on speaking to this. I came for the Franklin Road streetscape resolution, but being that I live on Fair Street and do have an opinion, I'm thankful to have the chance to speak, and I'll be brief. I do like the bump outs. They are not a panacea. They don't completely stop the traffic from going as fast as we see happen so often. I've seen them go whizzing past my home every bit of 50, 55 miles an hour, and the crazy thing is I live at the end of the street. I live at the stop sign. I've got two small children, and I worry for them. I think they're nice to look at. I think they're aesthetically pleasing. I think they do some to slow down traffic. So I will disagree with my friend Sam and say that I'd like to see them all stay, because I think they help, and every little bit of help when you have two small children really matters. Thank you.
Thank you.
So where are we going from here?
I think...
We have a resolution to vote on tonight.
Yep.
In the voting session. Go ahead.
I'm Ann Little, 916 Fair Street. And in regard to the petition that you have before you, I want it to be perfectly clear. I came and got it. It's the residents who signed this petition. And in composing what was going to be in the petition, there was a lot of conversation over weeks and months, actually, especially with the, once the sewer project was going on, that people said this would be a good time to take them out. And so the comments in there are citizens, not mine, but numerous people talked about it. And people just kept saying, do it, well, Ann knew how to get City Hall better than some of them, I think. So I came and got the petition, and I worked on the petition. And one of the things, there was a lot of discussion, and people who signed it read it, and if they didn't read it, I read it to them, and we discussed it. So I truly believe that the people who did sign it knew what it was about. Now, there may have been a few new people that didn't quite understand all the repercussions, but the people that signed this, it wasn't a pressure thing. I asked them what they thought about them. They didn't know I had a petition until I heard what they had to say, and then I told them, do you want to sign it or not? There were numerous ones, and I had a cover letter that said how many didn't for different reasons. I hope y'all got all of that. My biggest concern, and now I am speaking for Ann, the petition is what it still says, but as for Ann, I agree that the ones in the 1000 block definitely need to come out. They are a hazard. I think Ms. Peterson went and saw, I hope you stopped and saw the damage to that one there. I mean, it's got cracks in it like this where people have hit it. And when we talk about the safety of children, if someone hits that and something, a hubcap, something from a car comes off, and hits the numerous people that walk up and down that street, that is a serious hazard. There was a grandmother, she was my neighbor, she was walking with her granddaughter several years ago, at least two or three now, and someone hit it, and she literally had to lunge into a yard, pulling her granddaughter to keep from getting hit where the car bounced off. So that one definitely needs to be removed. Some of the people don't like anything about any of them. So if we need a consensus to work on something else, I think that's just something if we want to do. But the ones from my standpoint from at the 1000 block definitely needs to come out. I don't see with the distance between them and the ones that are actually right there at 9th, that goes over to 96. It's quite a distance in between there. So that's kind of my feelings. But I do want to make sure that I've been here and done this, and it's a difficult decision when people have a little bit difference of opinions on this. And so I appreciate all you do for Franklin. Thank you.
This is on the voting, so...
Yes, it is, with the petition as submitted.
You have something to vote on tonight. Number 10, withdrawal of Resolution 2012-74, a resolution awarding a construction contract for Eastern Flank Battlefield Access Roadway Project to Genco Construction in the amount of $1,026,386.39.
It's really 10 and 11 go together. We had we bid this project. This is the project for the Eastern Flank Battlefield Access Road, and this has about $500,000 of state grant, enhancement grant dollars, which is essentially federal money, federal highway money that's coming through the state for this project. Essentially, we had a deficiency in the low bidder. Terms of the bid bond form that they used was not proper, was not the designated form, and that is, in the eyes of Federal Highway, a material deficiency. And so working that back through the chain with the state to us, they have suggested that we move to the next bidder in this process, and that's what these two actions do. Is we had had a previous resolution recommended by the Capital Investment Committee, which was the low bidder. At that time, we did not know what the direction was going to be from Federal Highway through the state. We now have that, and it designates that we should go to the fully compliant bidder, which is the next one, which costs us around $60,000 more in the project.
Any questions about either one of those? Alderman Skinner?
We get federal money, it needs to be maybe double what we need out of the project. But you know, we're up against a kind of a deadline now, and it's very important that we get this done by 2014.
And I will add, the bids are good. Even the second bid are below what we had as an estimate going into the bid process, so we still feel like we're getting a good value. It's just not the lowest price that we got in the process. So if it was just us, we'd probably be awarding to the low bidder, but we understand the deficiency, and we understand the need in a project funded in this way to be completely no questions right about who you're awarding to.
Okay, number 12, consideration resolution 2012-63, adopting the Long Lane Overpass as a City of Franklin priority project and commitment to fund the project within the next several years.
This is really a follow-up. This item has been before you in a couple different forms. There was a public meeting a week or so ago on this. And again, this is really to move forward with an understanding with TDOT. And Tennessee Department of Transportation has worked with us to construct three bridge piers as a part of their I-65 project that would serve to be the piers for the Long Lane overpass, which would ultimately be funded by the city. But that saves us money on a couple fronts, in that Tennessee Department of Transportation will pay for those piers, and then it saves us mobilization and construction costs, because those are in place. We don't have to disrupt traffic nearly as much because those are already there. So those are two reasons that help us. This is an element that is in your major thoroughfare plan and has been anticipated with the development that is going on out there. And just open that up for any other discussion you have. This is also on your voting session tonight.
Alderman Skinner.
One thing I want to recognize is that the state did accept kind of the vague wording on the resolution that over several years, if funding is available, they accepted.
That's not vague.
That's vague.
Fund the project again.
So,
clearly the state's been.
In legalese, that's vague, right? You know, we passed out
and fewer than many.
Right. We passed out what the demand is going to be on the other side of 65, and I think to take the opportunity to save $400,000 on this project, and I'm not naive enough to know that this is going to happen in the next two, even 3 years, but if this is a placeholder for us. For the project, and it makes it easier for us to do it once we do have the funding for this on down the road, I think this is a smart decision. I mean, what's the state going to do? If we don't build this in 4 years, they're going to come tear the piers down? They just want to make sure that these things won't be sitting there 20 years from now. And believe me, if we have this kind of growth east of 65, we will need these long before then. So. It's a smart thing to do. The state approached us with this, and I think we just need to take advantage of the opportunity here.
Alderman Branchman.
So this is one other project we need to put on or add to CIP.
This would be another one in that
so
mix.
So we're looking at first quarter.
No, it's in your CIP already. It's just
not it'd be part of your
top priority, which, again, is hanging out there for several years for you to make a decision.
Okay. I agree. I think there's a need for, I mean, I'm not against it, but I think we need, in the big scheme of prioritizing, we need to be aware.
Alderman Peterson.
I have a couple of things.
One is that when it says financial impact, no financial impact, I think that is not...
Right now.
Not right. Because it is a commitment from us. I mean, we're, you know, it is not saying if we eventually have the money, it is that we will do it at some point. The part that is not said is the timeframe. The other thing is, and I don't know whether, how many of you looked on the material that we got in our item, the very last page of that has something that has been a concern of mine. But not just that, it's just something that I've known about from being on planning. If you look on the very, and could we get the very last page?
Yeah, we're going to pull that up.
Thank you. Right there.
Got it.
If you see, the red dot at the top is the long lane under discussion at this time. If you notice, it's 1/2 mile away from Goose Creek Bypass Interchange. And that is closer, I think, than any of our, you know, this has the long thing here. I mean, it has all these pages here where I don't see that there's a, the only thing that would be that close together is Moore's Lane and Baker's Bridge overpass there. But my other point is that, again, on that last one, there is also proposed 1/2 mile south of Goose Creek, another crossing, not an interchange, but another crossing similar to the long lane crossing that we're looking at right now. And I did ask, and it hasn't been passed out to everyone, but my question was, is this second one, the one to the south that goes between it's all Berry Farms down in there in three
in Stream Valley.
But the Chadwell and Reams Fleming part, if you look on the back of the item, that I'd like to keep that up just for a moment, but for those of us, if you look on the back of the sheet that they handed out to us today, if you notice, the Chadwell track has over 1.5 million square feet proposed for retail and office, and the Reams Fleming has over 2 million square feet proposed for
commercial retail.
For retail and office.
Yeah.
There. And so all the time, for a great part of the time when we began to talk about this, I was under the impression that we were talking about that crossing in between those two heavily proposed heavily developed office and retail areas there, because that's kind of what Baker's Bridge does. It goes between, you know, the very heavy, office and the very heavy retail on the other side there. And really, I did go out there and look to see where Long Lane was, and I looked at it on the map before I went some time ago. But as I say, in my original idea was it was going to be this one. And so now, from what I've been told tonight, although I don't think anybody else has seen it except me, that other one is not a developer crossing. It is also a crossing that the city would fund.
Is that the underpass?
No, we decided to go over, not under. TDOT wouldn't do under.
Yeah, this is another crossing, and essentially.
Yes, you can see both of them there, and there, as I say, the one that we're looking at tonight is 1/2 mile to the north of Goose Creek. The other one is 1/2 mile south of Goose Creek, and they, from what I understand, is when I got to the City Hall tonight, is that they are both projects that the city would be expected to fund.
The developer on the southern crossing, according to the 2006 ordinance on this, is responsible for providing the engineered construction documents for that roadway and the associated right-of-way. It does not define how the construction gets paid for. It says they'll provide for the design and for the right-of-way you need to accommodate that design. So that's their responsibility. That work is not eligible for offset in the road impact fees according to this 2006 ordinance, and we can get you a copy of that. But we just turned this up in response to a question from Alderman Peterson today. So I wanted to make sure that was clear in terms of what the responsibilities are. So the actual construction is not, cost is not defined in here. So that would be something you have to look at.
But why would the city be responsible for that? I mean, I know you're not saying the city would be. You're saying we don't know.
We didn't define it. We didn't put it on the developer. It's not defined here.
Why couldn't you define it and say it would be the developer? Why would that be the city's responsibility?
In 2006, when that ordinance was going through, it was not defined in that way. So that's all I can tell you as far as the answer to that.
It is on your major thoroughfare plan. Both crossings are there.
Because that, like almost anything else, is often negotiated. And right-of-way in engineering is extremely expensive, and we already collect road impact fees where appropriate. And so to some, and I don't know for sure that road impact fees would be triggered here, but to some extent, if they're paying road impact fees, it's a bit of double dipping, if you will. Now, again, I don't know for sure, but I mean, it's always easy to look back and wonder why our predecessors didn't drive a harder bargain. But I can promise you that engineering fees and right-of-way are huge components of the deal, particularly when you're talking about overpasses.
Could I say, first of all, I don't think that this was any different from, you know, whenever we were looking at the one for Long Lane over here. And by the way, Baker's Bridge was paid for by the city. So it was, really it wasn't anything out of the ordinary.
Right.
And maybe that's what you were saying about that. However, since that time, the road impact fees for at least the last 4 years and probably five have not paid. The road impact fees that we have collected in the city have not paid for the principal and interest on the projects that have already been built and we have borrowed the money for. So it's not as if that...
Well, we kind of got the rug yanked out from under us a little bit by forces beyond our control.
Absolutely. But I'm just saying, remember that all of these new projects that the city has agreed on, that's going to be an extra $2.5 million a year for the next 20 years. That is all coming from the general fund because we don't have enough money coming in on the road impact fees. And most of that $2.5 million, not all of it, but most of it is for road projects. So it's a matter of money again. And there are two of these here. And looking at the big picture, I have a concern. Do we think that we can do both of these along with a lot of other things that we're talking about doing? Or, if you can do one of them and not the other one, what do you do? As I say, just from the planning that I remembered, I was thinking it was going to connect the two, the money makers, the office and the retail, and because I remembered whenever those came through the Planning Commission. And I was really not aware until, after this had come up, that this part up in the northern part, even though there will be some commercial and retail over on the west side of the interstate here, it's not anything compared to what is planned down here. Now, the good news is the part north of Goose Creek is started now. But you know, how much are we saying that, how much have we projected out that the Long Lane overpass will cost? I'm going to say $6.7 million. $6.7 million. That's for everything on it. But if you look on this other part, even if they do the, even if the developers do the construction drawings and the part that would be the property there, which is their property right now, so you know what I'm trying to say, that they actually control that, that cannot be a big percentage. It is a, it will be a, an, you know, to all of us, a large amount of money, but it's percentage-wise, that's not very much. Actually, to tell you the truth, percentage-wise, the $300,000 for the piers is what, 5%? No, less than 5%. Shelly, is that right? Less than
5%?
No, I have it. But no, isn't it?
We spent $300,000 on design associated with the overpass overall. I don't know if we know specifically the cost for the piers. Do we know that?
We had an estimate that was around those numbers.
Okay.
$70,000 or something like that?
Well, I think Ms. Peterson's point is, well, to the extent that it is, would we do this if DDOT weren't driving the boat, is well taken, but they are. So this is a target of opportunity.
You have a window.
This is a target of opportunity, yes or no? Mm-hmm. I mean, nobody is saying that we would go out and do this on our own. It's only come up because TDOT presents it as an option that saves us money eventually, assuming that we ultimately do it.
But here's the question. When they go on down to the other part, which they're getting ready to do right away, will they also give us another opportunity for this south of Goose Creek? Because that's their next part. You know, they're planning to go all the way down to 840.
Well, but that might be a set of piers that would sit there for 20 years, so.
Well, either of them might if we don't pick one.
Yeah.
I do think it is not unwise to consider that we almost surely won't do both anytime soon. And so to the extent that Ms. Peterson is suggesting that this may be the wrong set, that may be so.
And I don't know that. I don't know that at all. But I think that needs to be a part of the discussion. Whenever I looked to see, and whenever I found out, I did not know how close they were, to tell you the truth, until this week.
We need to remind ourselves that these projects that are north of Highlands of Ladd Park, there's about 2,500 units there. The only way for them to get north and south is this road that we've approved. Mm-hmm. And then if they're going south, the only place will be the Goose Creek interchange. So this gives us another opportunity to get east and west across there. These things down in the lower section of Berry Farms, I doubt if these are going to come out of the ground in our lifetimes, because they're still phasing the Town Crescent Center. It's like Dana said, this is an opportunity. Not only in saving my time, but once we do decide to fund it, we won't have to beg permission from the state to disrupt I-65.
We've got one citizen that wants to comment on the Long Lane overpass.
Evening. John Sproul, chair of the newly organized PAC committee at Highlands of Ladd Park. And I can tell you right now, we've had amazing amount of interest from our little neighborhood already.
Yes.
A couple hundred homes, and I think a few of you have maybe received some supporting requests for emails. And we're expecting, as you know, all the growth that's been approved and looked at previously from you all. So we've appreciated all the support. We appreciate what's going on with Carruthers. And I'd say, obviously, the expense area that you're dealing with, you've got the master plan, and it's a major issue. I was not aware of the southern Baker's Bridge type overpass. I do know the Baker's Bridge that is built has been a very useful passover for the two sections of town. I see that being the same opportunity here for Long Lane, not only for commercial, but as I understand it, for getting access for residents for school, for going across for the high schools and for the junior highs and elementary. There's a lot of back and forth right now using the Goose Creek. The other issue that really surfaced for us, and just the one additional point, is made reference to safety, to our safety and response time for emergency vehicles. And I had a neighbor, we encouraged him not to come tonight, but he, a neighbor, an 87-year-old grandmother, who had a who fainted and needed emergency service, and in their calculation took almost 20 minutes to get emergency service out there because of traffic and turns and all. And in last week's report, you know, overall this response time is excellent in town in Franklin, and that just concerns us. And we feel that that type of access and not having to hassle the lights and all at the Goose Creek would expedite that and make it a make it a bigger a safety issue, important, deal with a real important safety issue for us.
We certainly hope that will be better after the
other project, the Carruthers project.
Absolutely.
Is done.
Yes.
Obviously, that's going to make a lot of difference.
Yeah.
Out there.
And we understand the timeline. So, yeah, everything we understand is happening there, both, I think, would be helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Spruill.
And I have had a number of people who correspond with
me about this. Again, I'm trying to look at a bigger picture. And, you know, probably everyone knows how I feel about having extra money committed to. But as I say, I think in terms of planning, you have to look at a bigger picture. Again, whichever one might be better, but do people think we're going to do both of them?
Alderman Barn here.
You know, I'll make this rather brief. At some point in time, whoever builds it, it's going to need to be built. We have an opportunity to leverage some money and be a step ahead on this particular project. We've got the engineering cost already included into that, and you know, we can kind of, I guess, not muddy the water between north of Goose Creek and south of Goose Creek and a project Berry Farm and Reams Fleming and this and that. But right now, we've got projects, major projects going on in Highlands, Nichols Bend, Simmons Ridge, and those projects. And you've got them on Berry Farms also. So I see it being an opportunity for us with the state to go ahead and be slightly ahead of the curve on a bridge that at some point in time is going to be needed. And I don't see, maybe I'll get something, to me several years is not three or four. Several years is more. Three or four is within the horizon of where we would look. But I see several years being more than three or four years.
Be medical talk, whenever they used to ask me how many more days I'd be in the hospital, I'd say several. I said, what does that mean? I said, 2 to 20. So.
Anybody else have any comments we want
to? I just wanted to follow up in terms of our recommendation is to move forward with this agreement. I think looking at the major thoroughfare plan and the magnitude of development that's expected out there, you're going to need connectivity, and both these are going to come into play. I don't know when you're going to need them exactly and when that funding is going to make sense for you, both on a need and a financial capacity basis, but it is a window of opportunity to get it done and to help that be a much more compatible project to deliver on when that time comes. And so that's where we're at. It is in your major thoroughfare plans, both crossings. My answer is you're probably going to need them both, given the magnitude of development that's on this sheet. Don't know when, but it will be needed.
I believe that the projected traffic on this in 20 years is 8,000 vehicles a day. The last Baker's Bridge traffic that I have seen, which is at least 2 years old, it was already 16,000. So in other words, double what this would be in 20 years. So that's kind of what I was taking on the commercial and office. Down the other side.
It would be. Okay, number 13, discussion regarding police department assistance with local funeral processions. Alderman Blanton had asked that this come back to the discussion group. So
I don't know, Alderman, would you like us to start, or would you like to say something first, or have, okay.
When this was brought up before, I mean, while we do have people speak to it publicly, you spoke to it. The more I kind of dug into it, we are passing along a fee, regardless of how that's funneled, whether it's through the funeral home or the police department. And I didn't feel like everybody really spoke on it. I felt like we were kind of like pushing it through. And I wanted to give an opportunity. I think that for me, this is something I think deserves discussion. I think it affects everyone in the community, whether it's obviously not their death, they're gone, but the families around that, and it's something we've done for a long time. I know that doesn't always mean that you continue it, but you know, even when it comes to manpower and looking at the way the police department's structured, I mean, we have a traffic division. So that's a part and above and beyond the 6 to 8 officers we have per, and that's probably wrong, Chief Rudinsky, how many people we have out per shift? 6, I think, is what we had said. 6 to 8, good?
It generally runs 8 to 10.
Okay, 8 to 10. So I think, I just wanted a little bit more discussion. I think that it's something that's been a tradition for so long, and not every alderman weighed in when we spoke about it before. I don't know what your reasons is for that, but I just think that it's something that needed a little bit more discussion, the opportunity for people to weigh in, because I think it matters. So.
Well, Mr. Mayor, I appreciate the information that was provided by the chief here to break down his manpower per day per shift, and that was significant. And also that his department has been supporting when able, these kinds of things, and that's great. Also has created opportunity for planned off-duty people to be a part of this process. So to me, that gives me some satisfaction that when I die, no, that my family can arrange for our escort, or the funeral home themselves may have cars that you can put the little blinking lights on and they can go through traffic.
That is correct.
So we have that. I mean, they can do that.
Yes, they can.
And go through the lights and the stop signs and whatever with the little blinking.
Tennessee code does allow them to do that. Subsequent to our initial public meeting regarding this issue, we met on December 14th, the mayor, the city administrator, myself, and representatives from each of the funeral homes. And we discussed the issue, the pros and cons in terms of using extra off-duty officers would give them a dedicated body, not subject to availability, not subject to recall, but dedicated for the length and duration of the funeral escort. The other issue that we discussed is the possibility of using one officer as opposed to two for smaller funeral escorts. And in addition, we would look to support escorts when we were on duty. If we're not on a call or not patrolling in a specific region or part of the city in regards to a directed patrol or citizens' concern, if we saw an escort that was taking place to assist them through the heavier, more congested intersections along the route.
To help with intersections, use on duty to help with intersections, that could be something that if they've hired an officer or two officers, depending on what their decision is, that could be coordinated as well.
That's correct.
So Alderman Blanton, I see it as a good thing that it's working out. There will be, there are options, in my opinion.
Well, and what was the general consensus from the meeting with the funeral homes? I mean, we didn't really get a report back. Yeah.
Right. I'm reluctant to speak for the funeral homes. I can tell you that of the three that were represented, one shared an email with us saying that we were below market cost for similar or comparable services, and if the need were to arise, he would use us without hesitation. Waters on Columbia said that it generally doesn't affect them. They've been using TCA.
They do their own.
The authority, the TCA, empowers them in terms of their own escorts. They've been doing their own. And Williamson, I know Pam Stevens is with us tonight, so I'm reluctant to say Pam's. She was unable to make the meeting on December 14th. She chose to get married instead. I felt that the dialogue was good. I felt that we understood each other's position. And even tonight is a good example. The Mellow Mushroom events will require two off-duty officers. The diabetes tour de force that was also on the agenda will require seven off-duty officers. The Franklin Main Street Brew Fest will require six off-duty officers. We have so many special events, and with the city being 41 square miles and the traffic being what it is, for me to be comfortable in terms of us to get to the farthest reaches of our jurisdiction, be it Clover Cross, Elementary, or south of Goose Creek, I feel that this is the most sound decision to make from a managerial perspective in terms of our resources.
I just think that there's a great advantage of having a dedicated officer to this instead of taking the chance that something would come up in the city and they would have to be pulled off of an escort if it wasn't this dedicated. That, for people that don't live around here, that would be a calamity. So this way it's predictable. You know that officer is dedicated. He's not going to be pulled off for anything else. Or they have the option of operating their own. I don't know what else we could say.
Alderman Martin.
I just really do not understand what difference it makes if there's a uniformed police officer at the head of a funeral procession or a car that's designated by the funeral home. I don't want a procession, but a lot of people do. But if, as long as you got that light and you've got the go-ahead to go, I don't see what difference it makes if there's a uniformed officer in the car or a man in a black suit. I just don't really see the difference. I don't see the need for a police officer.
If I outlive you, Bob and I are going to
No, you're not.
It will involve a bulldozer.
You're not going anywhere else. It's going to be down Main Street.
They're going to bury you the floor of the church, right there.
And the street will be closed. Main Street will be closed. Don't worry.
Excuse me. Don't get a permit for that.
We're ready to move on to 14, consideration of agreement between the Department of the Army and Metropolitan Government of Nashville and Davidson County and City of Franklin, City of Brentwood, and Williamson County for the Harpeth River, Tennessee feasibility study. We got into this last time, and we didn't really have enough time to ask a lot of questions, and so we're going to devote some time to this to make sure everybody understands the study. So welcome back. And
we have Craig Carrington from the Army Corps with us. I'll ask staff to just give a quick overview, and then we'll open it up to questions about how the feasibility study fits into what we're trying to do.
In order to allow for more time for questions, I just want to highlight that previously there seemed to be a misconception that it was a foregone conclusion we were going to build some sort of a dam on the Harpeth River. That is not the case. It is a feasibility study to look at various options of what could be done. Those are listed in the memo that we provided for you in the pack and include structural alternatives, which could be bridge modifications, channel widening, cutoffs, levees, flood walls, and regional dry detention. I want to kind of bring your attention to a dry detention or a dry dam, yeah, as been mentioned before. You have something similar to this that we built already, and that is the dry creek or dry branch, actually, detention facility and wetlands that we built at Moore's Lane and Franklin Road. What that does is it diverts the higher flows into another area versus going down the stream bed itself. Now, what would be proposed probably if you did the Harpeth River would be larger. It probably would not have wetlands. It could be multiple ones versus just one, keep it smaller. It could be used for parklands. It could be used for cultivation still by farmers or whatever. But that's the general idea of what you're looking at. You don't take all the water, or you don't dam up all the water that's in the stream. You take the higher flows and divert those somewhat. Other issues, other things that could be looked at is non-structural alternatives, wet flood Proofing, flood-proofing, ring levees, place, rising in place, excavations and relocations. That has to do with your structures, trying to protect those structures from any potential flooding. The other thing is erosion control and stream bank stabilization. We've had some of that happen with the removal of the Lowhead Dam. We'll point out to you as part of our stormwater management program. When we set that up here in the city of Franklin, we chose not to dwell on the Harpeth River itself, since we did not have the control of the Harpeth River, could not do some of the things just as we wanted to do. We're doing the tributaries to the Harpeth River. We're making most of our gains as far as any pollution control, flooding control, et cetera, on the tributaries to the Harpeth. The Corps of Engineers has the control of the Harpeth River. What this would do, if we go through this with the Corps and we get some alternatives and look at those, it would bring us back to where we may be involved in some excuse me, some improvements on the Harpeth River itself, which, as I said, our program does not address that at this time. And then other things is riparian zone restoration. So that's what this is all about. It's not about building another dam on the Harpeth River. I want to make sure that everybody is fully aware of that. So
it creates a menu of options of different ways you can deal with flood control throughout the region. Creates a platform too to partner with other jurisdictions in the region, as well as federal grant opportunities that you could pull from, because you've done it based on a feasibility study that you worked on with the Army Corps. So it really creates a menu for you to work from in the future for potential options, large, small, all variety, as David described.
And there are many steps in this process, and the city of Franklin can choose to pull out at any one of those steps. You will have decisions as a board to be making during the process, and you can choose to pull out of the contract or pull out of the agreement.
Or
at
out
any
of
time,
a specific project.
Or a specific project itself, so yes.
First question I saw was from Alderman Bransford, if you're ready.
All right.
I'm ready.
Okay, I just, this 246.8 money here, that's over a three-year period that we will be paying that, our portion.
Yes, ma'am.
And will the study take the 3 year to do?
Yes, ma'am.
It would be a three-year study?
It would, with ultimate approval by Congress at the end of that 3 years.
Okay.
We would have information much sooner than that 3 years.
That's what I was wondering. So, yeah.
And we would fund that through our stormwater fund.
Okay. Over a three-year period, and we will have information, maybe a little bit of information each year, or would it just be one study at the end of 3 years?
Yes, you would have quite a bit of information. It would actually be the first 18 to 19 months, you would have the majority of your new information together, and you would have some of those preliminary list of measures that could make some kind of impact.
Okay, thank you.
Alderman Skinner, then Alderman Martin.
I want to apologize, Mr. Garrison. I think last meeting I asked some harsh questions. And it wasn't my intent to attack the project or you. It was, there were a lot of questions I had that I didn't see in our material. And if this was the time to ask questions, you know, that's what we needed. One thing I would ask is that it looks like the makeup for the people that work on this. Could we also have some of the other groups that work on the Harpeth have their input to be assigned on this too.
Oh yes, we've already
Harpeth Valley. I mean, Harpeth River Association.
Yes, as we will have a lot of stakeholders, a lot of what we call non-government organizations, NGOs, to include the Nature Conservancy, the Harpeth River Watershed Association, any other citizen groups that I'm not aware of. Yes, we would be welcoming their input. Would hold various public meetings, possibly hosted here in the City Hall, where people could come and learn more about the project, give their feedback to what they think the problems and opportunities are in the Harpeth. Be very, very open.
This is an opportunity for us to look at what the opportunities would be for us to head off some flooding that we've experienced here. So I'd be in favor of this.
What is our stormwater fund balance?
Somewhere around $5 million.
Approximately $5 million. You've got some projects assigned to that that will draw that down some, but it is.
People always ask what that fee is for. We can say, hey, you don't fund studies about flooding, so.
And projects.
I have had two residents phone me and say that they were not in favor of spending a dime on this, that they felt that we had addressed the river by removing that dam and had addressed a lot of our destroyed properties after the flood, and they really didn't want to see us spending any more money on even a study. I just wondered, did you check into the dam, the 30-year plan that I mentioned to you before?
No, ma'am, I did not. I know you mentioned, I believe, the Columbia Dam, mm-hmm. and I may have been a little confused.
If the Corps of Engineers had planned to build a dam down around Columbia,
yeah.
and it would have, it decreased our floodplain by about 85%, which would have eliminated a lot of our problems.
And I may have been mistaken or confusing that with the dam on the Duck River that was at one time proposed by the Tennessee Valley Authority. So I should have followed up.
Well, you know, maybe I'm mistaken.
If you don't mind.
What?
The Corps of Engineers did a study on the Harpeth River back in like 85, 86. Well, that was the first one. There was the latest one was 86 or so. But it had a recommendation of a dam on the Harpeth River would have been a 30 million gallon per day supply of water, et cetera. That was not, did not come out to be feasibly, economically feasible. It did not meet the benefit cost ratio that was needed to be able to go forward with that. There were some other issues or other things recommended in that. But that was a study done out, it's either 86 mm-hmm. or 87. I think it was finally finished in 86. But mm-hmm. But that there was no work done as a result of that particular study. That dam was going to be up. Actually, it would have made my property Lakeview property, but it was not done. It would have been in the eastern part of the county.
Maybe you're the one that didn't want it.
I didn't want it. I'll put it that way. As far as the way it was proposed, no, because it would have been a mud flat out there. That's another story, but that was the study as far as the latest study as far as looking at a dam on the Harpeth River.
The pricing here is, you know, quite high for Franklin. According to the, we talked about this last time, mm-hmm. right? The riverbed mileage of it that actually exists within the city limits.
Yeah, a combination of that and the amount of damage received in the May 2010 event.
Versus us, versus Williamson, versus the whole county. And then I got Nashville, but the thing is, what is that mileage, that riverbed mileage?
I'm not prepared. I don't know the breakup.
I'd like to know that
mileage
at some point.
Sure.
We can get that. The way it was broken out was we looked at Franklin and what was south, upstream of Franklin, and that cost was essentially assigned to us. From Davidson County south to the city of Franklin limits was assigned to Metro as part of their cost, so we would not be essentially paying for that hydraulic study that goes into Metro, just what's impacting Franklin.
All right. Mm-hmm. Well, at some point, that might be helpful to have, but I understand, you know.
Alderman Peters.
Is there a breakdown on the number of structures in each of these jurisdictions that were affected? I think there was about a total of over 600. Is that correct? Was in the floodplain?
Correct. And I can get you the breakdown by municipality. And the dollar amounts.
There's probably a fairly large amount in the city of Franklin, and then, as you say, in Davidson County, on
yes.
the other end.
Yes, ma'am. That's
not,
true.
Not so much in Brentwood or the county, either one, I suspect.
Correct.
Other questions? Well, we appreciate you coming back, and sorry we couldn't get to all the questions last time.
Thank you for having me.
Continue to move forward. Thank you. Number 15, consideration proposed First Bank lease at 510 Columbia Avenue, downtown Franklin, City of Franklin, contract number 2012-0175. And you've got a...
We did give you a slightly updated version from today. A couple of the blanks that had been in the draft that you had were updated, and I'll let Shauna go over that real quickly to describe those. This is a lease that reflects the terms that were identified in the letter of intent that we voted on back in December, and then fills in some other more standard lease terms to round out the complete lease. Really, I know we're running out of time in our work session, so I respect that, but I'll give Sean a quick chance to just talk about the little bit of language that was added and how we decided to, working with First Bank, to describe the term and when the lease payments initiate and the lease itself begins to run.
Okay. The lease will be signed the day that the board votes on it. So if we were to take it up on February 12th and it was not deferred, it would be effective, or it would be signed on February 12th. And what happens at that point, that gives the bank the ability to go forward with all of their financing and the application for working with the State Historic Preservation Office, which they would like to see a formalized lease. But what happens, as far as you're concerned, in paragraph 2, you'll see it says that it starts from the earlier date of July 1, 2013, or the date the lessee is issued a building permit. So that means that this lease will become effective, hopefully, when they get a building permit. Hopefully, that can happen before July 1 or July 1. And at that point, they will be paying us rent, and the lease becomes effective, and all the terms become effective of that date.
So that rent payment and that 20-year clock starts on that, either that July 1 or when that building permit is issued. That July 1 is the latest date.
And that's really the big things we changed from the first draft you got to the second draft. We did add the notice requirements in paragraph 14, and then we added the name for the signing on page 9 of 9. And then, of course, we added the exhibits to make the full packet. Do you guys have any questions about the lease?
Well, initially it was a $3.5 million investment.
Now it's reflecting 3.0. So where did the go down?
Well, we're not worried about the amount. What we're worried about is
the actual building.
Yeah, exhibit B. The items in Exhibit B have to be completed.
Okay.
And if they can get it under 2.5,
got it.
That's up to them.
I just wanted to make sure we had enough.
$4 million, that's not our issue. It's that, right, that building program,
okay,
gets completed.
Got it. So you kind of switched
gears
on that.
Yeah, they put an estimate out there. We for the financial calculation, used $1 million. That would be the city's responsibility regardless of doing this deal. We think that's really more like $2 million, but
right,
we're trying to be conservative in that number. Mm-hmm. But that $3 million is really their estimate of the cost of those, that series of improvements. But we wanted to clearly define that group more than a number.
And they're also having to work with the historic,
State Historic Preservation Office, as well as the city's historic.
So from an aesthetic situation, like, I don't like the blue awnings, I've said that from the beginning, yeah, but I mean, somebody's going to be there to make sure everything is done and period.
Historically.
Okay, got it.
Right.
It'll work for the both local and state process.
And it says expected to be an aggregate amount of $3 million, but, you know,
okay,
expected.
Now, as long as we've covered our bases in words and not money, then I'm fine with that.
Alderman Skinner, and then Alderman.
I had a question. Will public parking be available when the bank is not in operation?
I'm glad you said that, because we did add that one.
Did you add that?
In paragraph 1, the very last sentence, we added, with regard to parking areas comprising the leased premises and related language, the lessee shall have the exclusive use thereof, subject to applicable city ordinances and regulations. So we assume they're going to sign it that will say for bank and tenant parking only. How they use it on the weekends, I don't know. We have a representative here. I don't know what they would do with parking on the weekends.
Sure. That parking is used a lot sometimes on the weekends. I'd hate to lose that if you're not in operation. Do y'all?
If we're not open on the weekend, we're not going
to. Yeah.
Yeah. Can.
Britt Boatwright, I'm the Nashville president of First Bank. If we're not open for business, then we're not going to monitor what's going on. We're not going to monitor who's parking at the lot. During bank hours, we do need to make sure we've got enough accessibility. That's our intent.
Well, that's a good question, because there are some businesses that put up a sign that says no parking allowed even on weekends. And this is a very active downtown.
That's not our intent. Yeah. We've not gone down that road, but that's not our intent.
That would be good neighborly to be able to have that.
Sure. We're trying to make,
did you say something like during banking hours or?
At this point, we just put out that we need to make sure we can have some control so that we've got enough parking for our customers, employees, and our tenants. So that's as far as we've taken.
And the second question, is there anything in here that would prevent them from building additional structures?
Historic zoning?
Yeah,
they have to go through the development process. Yeah.
Historic zoning, and we would have to agree to it. I mean, yeah. Any sort of capital improvement has to be, and that's why Exhibit B includes all the things that we're okay with renovating. If they wanted to build something, we would have to bring that before you.